Hi, I'm Matt.
Hi, and I'm Denise.
And welcome back to another edition of Urban Lifestyle. As always, I think we have a great show.
Indeed it is. I think every show is great.
You are correct. And on this week's show, we will be talking with Mike White about our Father's House and the program that he has to help people that are going through recovery. We also did a piece with Tony, who was in town for a concert. And then we have our segment with LGNE, which is about Energy Matters. So we'll take a quick break and back with more of Urban Lifestyles right after this.
In the whole universe, there's only one you. But even though we're unique, we do have one thing in common. We want to live long, healthy lives. That's why Kentucky One Health should be the one name you think of for award-winning heart, stroke, and cancer care. The one name for convenience. With over 200 locations, including hospitals, outpatient care centers, and physician practices. And the one name for wellness. With healthy lifestyle centers and partnerships across the state. With the combined experience of Jewish and St. Joseph Hospitals and the University of Louisville Hospital, Kentucky One Health is the one name in healthcare.
You know, if you've been around the Louisville community at all, you know Mike White.
Yes.
You have to be familiar with his work because he is a very engaged individual and he definitely believes in giving back. One of the programs that he has is called Our Father's House, and every year he has an annual picnic. We could also call it a celebration. So take a look at this piece.
Well, I'm here with Mike White, and Mike White is well known in our community for giving back. He has a very warm spirit, and I think I'm being very, 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 very kind from that perspective. You have done so much in this community, and one of the things that I think is one of your greatest platforms is Our Father's House, and it's something that really deals with sobriety. So talk to us about what's happening with Our Father's House.
Okay, well, Our Father's House is a sober living home for men, where we help men and women to get out of the lifestyle of using drugs and alcohol. But today is a major day. Today is our Father's House Founders Day. It was the 13th anniversary, which you can see we got a whole lot of people out here having fun. We have the mayor come out, the chief of police. We get to save our city a lot of money from people breaking laws and coming back into society. You know, and we've been here for 13 years, and it's a blessing. If we save one person, in a million years from the pain that I was in 20 years ago, then I've done my job. But we get the blessings of all these people getting sober.
So tell us about the program, how does it work, and how can you explain the success?
Well, the success comes from we've been self-sustaining for over 13 years. Each man comes in, we help him find a job, we teach him about recovery, we give him responsibility, they come back, they give back to the new man, and it continues to cycle. We concentrate on the newest man in recovery and newest woman.
So, you know, it's very important to have the support of the city, and I know you definitely have that. So talk about that partnership.
Well, in our industry, making sure that we're certified with the state and the local level and that our operations are in line. The city has been very helpful. The mayor's office is very helpful with our grants. We have a new resource center, which helps people get on their feet, and they're very supportive.
And I'm sure that some of the people here today that we see behind us, I'm sure they have some great testimonies.
Right.
And if you could just talk about one person, don't have to give any names, but just kind of give us an idea of what some of these people have gone through.
I've got one guy, man, we celebrated today, Cedric. Cedric is a guy that shows up. He's giving back to the new man every day. He comes over, he volunteers at the Resource Center. And it's just, you know, it's an honor to be able to see people's lives change. It is.
So what is something that you want the general public to know about what you do, and how can the general public have an impact on Our Father's House? And I know this is not your only venture.
Right, but the general public should know that if you have someone in your family that's suffering from alcohol and drug addiction, you can reach out to Our Father's House. You can find us at our-fathershouse.com, or you can come to the kyrrc.org, or you can reach us by just coming by 2310 West Jefferson. My main thing for the community is that we're here to help you.
And you are doing an excellent job. So what can we expect from our Father's House, and what else are you going to be doing to help uplift our community?
Oh, man, we've got this resource center coming up. We got a ribbon cutting on June the 3rd over on 2501 West Market at our resource center. We got a sober walk on September the 10th, which is going to be down by the Ali Center. Now, we need you to come out and support.
Mike, you are doing a whole lot. Where do you find the energy to get all of these things done?
With the help of God. The help of God.
I'm here with Pasquale Reynolds. Welcome to Urban Lifestyles. I was talking to Mike earlier, and he was talking about Our Father's House and just what the program has done for a lot of the people who've taken advantage of the services. What has it meant to you?
It means a lot to me, man. It helped me become a father, a productive citizen, just a man in general. It made me feel good about myself and my community. I can give back instead of taking.
How did you find out about Our Father's House?
I had a couple of friends that's been through the program, but honestly, it was God that brought me here. Because I could have went anywhere in Louisville, but I just felt like it's the place to be. And I just like it here. It's life on life's terms recovery.
I'm here with Tanya, who she is a member of Ladies of Promise, which is the sister house to Our Father's House. Tell me how you came in connected with Mike White and Sisters of Promise.
I came from Alabama 6 years ago, and they just transported me here, and I've been here ever since.
So what has this program meant for you, and how are you able to stay true to your mission to stay sober?
Just helping others. It's really changed my life. I'm in school. Mentoring, I'm staff member. Just amazing things. Got my kids, just amazing. Kids back, family back. Yeah, wouldn't change it.
So what is some advice that you have for someone else who may have struggled with the addiction that you have?
Just keep it one day at a time. Yeah, just one day at a time.
And once you do that, everything else is manageable.
It's in place. Yes, sir.
So how do you explain addiction to the novice, for the person that's on the outside, and we hear about alcoholic abuse and other things like that, and we just kind of like brush it off. It's like if they wanted to get straight, they could. How do you make that common person understand that?
I actually had to go through that myself, being an alcoholic. And the thing is to understand that it's a disease. It's not a choice. And that's a lot of people really just think that they can slap it out of you, tell you to stop, and that you can just stop. And it's really what it is changing your total mindset and changing the way that you think. And the only way that we can do that is truly working the 12 steps. And then we can kind of look back and see how crazy our thinking was. And I think there needs to be a lot more public education on that for people to really understand that really it's not a choice, but it's something that person has to do themselves and be willing to change themselves.
So what does it mean to you when you see someone, they came in, they were struggling, they had these challenges, and now they've completed the 12 steps?
Oh, it is so rewarding, because I've been working with the court systems as well, trying to get some referrals in from the courts. And some of these girls I kind of take on as my little sisters, and it's so rewarding to see them and to see the change, to see them grow up and actually not want to go back to jail, because in jail they can just sleep all day and be lazy. And it's just awesome to see them have the responsibility and start getting jobs and paying for their own ways and paying back their parents for money that they borrowed. And to me, that's one of the most rewarding parts of it, is to see that change.
You know, the picnic that he has, the celebration, I like to call it, it's always a great event, because a little bit of everybody comes through, the police chief, the mayor, you name it, people are just there to support Mike and his efforts.
One thing about Mike White is this, the word integrity. And also, Mike says what he means, and he means what he says.
And he gets it done. We'll take another break and back with more right after this.
Mothers, fathers,
neighbors and friends.
Working hard when the weather is good.
And even harder when it's not.
With online updates to keep you safe and informed during a storm.
Programs to save you energy and money.
And new projects to help us provide cleaner, more reliable energy.
We are more than an energy company.
We are LG&E.
We're LG&E.
We are LG&E.
Our energies.
Make them feel special this Father's Day with colors that pop from GQ Unlimited at 8th and Broadway and Indian Trail.
It's all about the colors, and that means blazers that you can coordinate for dress, casual, or any occasion. Accessorize your selections with great hats by Dodson Stetson and shoes by Stacey Adams. Slim cut suits by Sean John, Perry Ellis, and Ralph Lauren, and shoes by Stacey Adams.
Image matters, so trust GQ for all occasions and tell them Urban Lifestyle sent you. GQ, where the well-dressed dad shops and shops and shops.
You know, summer means projects, and project means digging in your yard, And sometimes if we don't make the right decisions, we pay for it on the end. So this month we're talking with Energy Matters with LG&E, and they're going to tell us some things that we should do before we dig. Take a look. Every month we have a segment with LG&E, and we call it Energy Matters. And I'm here with Liz Pratt. And, you know, we haven't been together in a minute, so welcome back. Good to see you.
Thank you. Appreciate being here.
So what's been going on?
Well, you know, this is the perfect time of year when a lot of folks want to go ahead and start planting in their yard or doing landscape work. And so we really wanted to talk today about the importance of making sure before you stick the first shovel in the ground that you have your underground utility lines marked.
And I am one of those people that has in the past been guilty of not making that call. But since our partnership, I call relentlessly. And I know some things that we should do is make sure that we call, what, at least 2 days in advance?
Yes, you want to make sure you call at least 2 business days in advance, and that'll give the partner utilities enough time to come out and have the lines marked. And this is not just for your safety, but it's for the public's safety. If by having your underground utility line marked and following the appropriate guidelines, it can prevent as many as 99% of accidental dig-in. So it's really important, not just for your safety, but it's also the law.
So Liz, you have Lisa with you today, and she's going to talk to us a little bit about what someone needs to know in terms of what's happening as it relates to looking for the underground wiring.
Yes, absolutely.
Hi. What they'll do is when you start your planning process of wanting to dig or your digging project, we want you to call 811 2 days prior to this, or you can click before you dig at 811 now.
Now, a lot of times people, you know, they're concerned about making that call, but also, is there any cost or anything associated with it?
No, it's absolutely free.
Okay. And tell us how that procedure works. What are the linemen looking for?
Okay, what you do is you either call or you can, like I said, click 811 now, and you enter your information, such as your street address or wherever your project is taking place, and they will come out and mark your underground utilities. And as you can see, the various utilities have been marked. They're color-coded, and once they have been marked, then you're okay to proceed with your excavation project.
So if you have a company that's going to come out and do some work, is it their responsibility to call, or is it you, the homeowner's responsibility? Who should make that call?
The person actually doing the digging.
Okay, so if that person fails to, it's probably a good idea for the homeowner to check up on it to make sure that it is occurring?
Yes.
Okay. And what are some of the things that can happen if that homeowner doesn't make the call? What are some of the trouble that you can run into?
Well, if you don't make the call and you put a shovel into the ground and hit a utility service, obviously it's going to cause an interruption in the service. One of the things we were talking about earlier, if you have teenagers that are gamers, then you know you're going to disconnect their internet service if you hit a internet service.
And that responsibility in terms of that cost for interrupting a service, that's going to fall on the homeowner, correct?
More than likely, yes.
Okay. And Liz, what are some other things that we should know?
Well, we want to make sure by putting in your locator request at least 2 business days, something to keep in mind is once the lines have been marked, that locate request is good for 21 days. So if you have a contractor that's coming out and doing work, be mindful of when you put in that request. Because if that request expires, you're going to want to go ahead and put in another request.
So it's something you have to make sure that you do within that 21-day period.
Absolutely. And also be mindful of the guidelines that are in place. Once your lines have been marked, make sure you follow the guidelines of how far you need to stay away from the utility lines, at least 18 inches. From where the lines have been marked. So you want to be mindful to follow the guidelines. All of these guidelines are available at 811now.com, or you can always visit lge-ku.com.
And one last thing, I noticed that the markings are different colors, and I'm assuming that that means something. It's not just because she has all these great paints and wants to use them, but they actually mean something.
Yes, they do. Yes. The color code, actually, once your lines are marked, the locator that actually leaves the markings will leave a door hanger for you, and there's a color code that goes along with it that will be on the card that they leave for you. But as you can see, the red represents electric, yellow represents gas, orange would represent communications such as cable or internet, blue represents water, and green is sewer.
All right. Well, you know, that's some great information. So if we're going to do a recap, first thing that the homeowner should do is if they're going to have some digging done, that contractor needs to make the call, and the homeowner should follow up with the contractor to make sure that they make the call. They should do it at least 2 days in advance. And then what else should happen?
Absolutely. So once your lines have been barked,
okay,
be mindful of the guidelines that are in place,
mm-hmm,
and make sure you follow the recommendations with your leave-behind materials.
Right. And you're going to stay a certain amount of space away from those lines once you find them.
Absolutely. At least 18 inches on either side of the lines.
So you can see why it's so important.
Before you dig, it pays to ask the question to LG&E, and that's specifically to you.
You are correct, and they said you should really make the phone call about 2 days beforehand to make sure you're allowing yourself enough time. And even though you have a contractor, they are supposed to make that call, mm-hmm, but if they don't, it's good to go to that contractor and say, hey, I know you're getting ready to plant some shrubs here. Did you call? And if they didn't, make sure that you do it yourself.
Yes.
We'll take another break and back with more right after this.
Jeff Waller Toyota, Southern Indiana's number one Toyota dealer. Hey folks, just take the bridge for savings. We're offering employee pricing for everyone who walks through the door. Remember, you pay what we pay. Come see me, Rodney Carter. We're closer than you think. Just take I-65, exit 4, Lewis and Clark Parkway, across from the Green Tree Mall, or visit us on the web at jeffwallerclarksvilletoyota.com.
Universe, there's only one you. But even though we're unique, we do have one thing in common. We want to live long, healthy lives. That's why Kentucky One Health should be the one name you think of for award-winning heart, stroke, and cancer care. The one name for convenience. With over 200 locations, including hospitals, outpatient care centers, and physician practices. And the one name for wellness, with healthy lifestyle centers and partnerships across the state. With the combined experience of Jewish and St. Joseph Hospitals and the University of Louisville Hospital, Kentucky One Health is the one name in healthcare.
Jeff Waller Toyota, Southern Indiana's number one Toyota dealer. Hey folks, just take the bridge for savings. We're offering employee pricing for everyone who walks through the door. Remember, you pay what we pay. Come see me, Rodney Carter. We're closer than you think. Just take I-65, exit 4, Lewis and Clark Parkway, across from the Green Tree Mall, or visit us on the web at jeffwallerclarksvilletoyota.com.
So, Denise, what is something that we're always looking for?
We are always looking for new show ideas.
You are correct. And if you've got a great show idea, be sure to go to our website at www.urbanlifestyles.net, and that's Lifestyles with a Z. And if we happen to use your show idea, you could win a free oil change from Jeff Waller Toyota. And, of course, if you're in the mood for a new or used car, go by and see Rodney Carter and tell him that Urban Lifestyles sent you. You know, the last piece that we're going to talk about today is something that's kind of fun. Tony, they've been to the city on numerous occasions.
Yes.
They always give a great show. And this interview with them was just kind of crazy because they were all over the place. They were having a lot of fun. We were having fun, so just take a look. Well, we're here on 4th Street Live getting ready for a great concert with Tony Tone. And they have been to Louisville on numerous occasions, and every time they come, they give us a great show. So, guys, welcome back to Louisville and welcome back to Urban Lifestyles. I'll let you all do your personal introductions here.
Yes, I'm Dwayne Wiggins, the Aquarius of the group. You
okay.
Know that, though, right?
I knew that.
I told you this is starting to feel like family. We've been here so much, right?
This is it.
So tonight is the night. If they missed it, they don't even understand. This is our anniversary.
Congratulations.
Yes. No, I'm just making that up.
It's
our anniversary.
I'm
saying, like, it's our anniversary today. This is what it's going to be, because we come around every year pretty much.
Okay,
right?
Cool.
It's a great gathering. But.
All right.
And my name is Larry.
And I'm a, no. No, my name is Amar Khalil. And yeah, man, I don't know. I'm a Libra, I guess, you know. Yeah,
man, so am I.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, it's all good. Not, yeah. Hey, man, go on, introduce.
And last but not least.
Hello. I'm Timothy Christian Riley, Sagittarius.
So tell me, you all have been together a long time, since the late 80s. The music's still going strong. How do you keep it going?
Doing shows, man. It's really about going to the people. We've always believed that, you know, as an artist, it's about uplifting and going out and, you know, shaking hands and meeting your folks and hopefully keeping a family. I'd have to attribute it to that, you know what I mean?
And how about you?
And just loving what you do. You know, we truly love performing, being on stage, using the gifts that God gave us. So, man, it's a blessing.
Tell me what you
need to
answer that.
Man, we a band. You know, that's it, man. We a band. You got to play. If you a band, you got to play.
That's it. Mm-hmm. So it's just out there getting in front of the public. So approximately how many shows do you all do a year?
You know, I would have to say upwards of 30, maybe 40, 50. You know, we're going to amp it up probably in the next year or so, because we've been gearing up to really go out and do some different things on the road and then stay out of the country a little bit more. So, you know, pretty much 40 dates at least.
So can we expect you all to be in the studio? What can we expect new from you all?
Always expect us to deliver a new group. We are always messing with what's the next thing, but you know, we're always doing music too.
So did you doing things, independent projects as well?
We're always trying to touch somebody.
Okay, this is a GP show.
Right? No. We're always trying to touch folks and do something different. We just try to lay hands on you, you know.
You can go a lot of different ways.
No, really and truly though. Spiritually, when we get out on the stage, it's like we levitate, you know what I mean? We up there playing, and our songs are our songs. Of course, we'll always record and play those classics, but we're also going to, you know, every now and then you may hear something new from us that we feel like will work, but we'll test it out on the crowd. We'll bust off something new and see what they say. And at any given moment, we are 100% self-contained. You know, we are independent. We've been independent since 1996, 97. Haven't been signed to a label, so we do it how we want to do it. We can go from club to the big stage to the whatever, and so we definitely will deliver new music, but it simply is like the score to our life right now.
I mean, it just sounds like that you all are very content. You're kind of at peace. You're doing what you want to do.
It's hella fun. I'm saying, it's not even, I mean, I hate to even call it, it's a party. It's the people get, you know, they can come and get on stage with us, whatever. We take it out there to them, and it's good. It's just a beautiful thing right now.
So when you leave Louisville, where are you all headed?
Carolinas.
Yeah. Well, it's back to San Francisco, then to the Carolinas. So we're going home, and then, or the Bay, and then Carolinas. We got hella dates. It's I don't know which all they are. I know we just got D.C. popping up. I love me some D.C. Yes.
So do you all still call the Bay Area home?
Of course.
Yeah. Well, it's always going to be home. I don't live there right. I don't live there right now, but it's still hometown.
So, what are some of the changes that you all have noticed in the music industry?
Ooh. You know, we came out when there was cassettes and then CDs. Well, we came out on wax, first of all. We are a wax group. That's our foundation. If you know, we put out something new about a year ago, and it's called It's a Beautiful Thing, and we released a limited edition of wax. And we just believe, and you know, it's always good to have something that you can hold on to and hold it. I like the digital thing. And that works for us because that's what's new. Now our stuff not only gets played on the radio stations, thank God, but these new formats like Spotify and Pandora, we got our own stations on those. And that's a whole nother lane for us. And we out. It's a blessing.
So what advice do you have for some of the new up-and-coming artists that are out there?
Just continue to grind. Continue to love what you do. Continue to learn, you know, and make it happen.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I agree.
Okay. So ditto.
We're going to dedicate this one in trueness to like Prince, because that's a gentleman that showed you it wasn't about the dough. You know, it's times you would see him go to do a show and that sound check, he's out there. Like you see a sound check, he's out there at the board, like the engineer. He's so passionate. So his spirit always lives on through true musicians like ourselves. And, you know, so he paved the way. All we got to do is go out there and keep doing what artists are supposed to do, inspire.
And,
And what did Prince mean to you all personally?
Oh, he meant the troops to me. You know what I mean? Because coming up in high school, he set the bar for musicians. You know, as he's one of the ones that inspired me to play more than one instrument and try to, you know, record all the instruments on my songs and stuff. I wasn't as good as him, but in my mind I was. You know what I mean? So that's what I can say I learned from Prince. But true passion, you could look at it all day. That gentleman was, he'd have, after he'd do a show, he'd go to do something at a club or at his house and jam. That's a passionate artist.
Anybody else want to add something about Prince?
I mean, you know, what can you really say? I mean, he was legendary. When Dwayne talks about inspiring, you know, he just kind of made you realize that you can do whatever you need to do. And no matter who you hit the stage with, man, you go for it and give it your all. And it doesn't matter who you're performing with, you know, so.
No, like Prince was one of, yeah, like Prince was one of like the best, man. And we actually got to like jam with him back when I was like 19 and like started working with him and been around him and hung out with him. So really, like, got the real, yeah, like a real, like, huge dose of it. So, no, but he was the greatest.
Right. Then being able to play at his club in Las Vegas and hang out and, you know, and being at concerts and he's sitting right next to you and y'all just sitting there like, okay, man, we up in here with Prince. And, you know, it was major. So I'm so glad that we were able to have that experience, because a lot of people, you know, you get the audience experience of it. But
you know, it was hard to get a handle on that interview because they were just like, they were just in their own world. They were having a lot of fun.
See, one would think after all these years have passed that they would be more low-keyed, and they are totally high energy.
They are. And they were just, I mean, they were just having a blast. They had a great time. The performance was great.
Oh, yeah.
The people came out and supported it, and it was just a great event.
It was the energy, and everybody felt that they gave it, and they received it back.
You are correct. And what are we going to be talking about on next week's show?
Next show, we're going to do the recap on the Derby City Jazz Festival. I hope you didn't miss it, but if you did, you can see some of the clips of everything you did miss. It was indeed the street takeover.
And we had a blast. And you know what? We don't want to talk too much about it now because we want you to tune into us when we talk about it on our next show. I'm Max.
I'm Denise.
And we'll see you back here next time on Urban Lifestyle.
Bye.
Bye-bye.